the president continued to sort of fly that red wave that he was the red flag in hopes for a red wave this this November today. I want to talk more about that whole event that he had today and just start with that idea of permanently separated. Kind of clever, certainly not subtle, as I mentioned to Boris. Let's just listen to it again.
These are the American citizens permanently separated from their loved ones. The word permanently being the word that you have to think about, permanently. They're not separated for a day or 2 days. They are permanently separated because they were killed by criminal illegal aliens.
Paul, you're a messaging guru. I know that this is the other side of the aisle for you and then some, but what do you think of what he's trying to do there?
He knows what he's doing. He's taking this raw, real pain that these poor families are suffering, which is authentic, and he's politicizing it, right? It is monstrous to take these folks' pain and then to try to use it to divide America. It is true, as we saw from the guy from the Customs and Border Patrol Agents Union, that the immigrant population commits fewer crimes. You know, why doesn't he have a meeting with families of people who've been killed by right-wing white nationalist extremists? You know, the ADL, the Anti-Defamation League, says 71% of all the extremist murders that have occurred in America in the last decade have been committed by white nationalist neo-Nazis. That's a real problem. That pain is real. But that shouldn't be exploited for politics either. And he doesn't seem very interested in folks, you know, who've been murdered by the extreme right. I don't know that he's ever met with the family of Heather Heyer, who was allegedly, she was murdered, but she was allegedly by right-wing extremists in Charlottesville. So that's the kind of politicization that is really monstrous.
This is clearly a political event. It doesn't take away from these families' pain.
Right.
I mean, it was heart-wrenching to watch this event. Having said that, what Paul said is right. According to multiple studies, Mary Catherine, there is actually less violent crime in states that have the most undocumented immigrants.
Yeah, that is true. And this is classic Trump to take something and politicize it in sort of the most aggressive way possible. But there's also a reason those families are with him and standing with him. And that is because they do feel an empathy gap and that people don't give their pain a lot of credit because it's uncomfortable to talk about and because I think it is not statistically representative and it's not great for crafting policy. But their pain is real and it does point out sometimes real gaps in our immigration system, which is a disaster and why we might need a comprehensive, smart legislative solution, but whatever. That, for instance, some of these people have been deported several times and come back to commit these crimes. So I think that's a problem worth pointing out. This is not the way that I would ever do it.
Right.
And I don't think that it, much like emotionalism on the other side, I don't think it gets us closer to an answer.
But for Donald Trump, this is familiar emotionalism.
Oh, yes.
I mean, this is how he started the day that he came down that escalator. This is how he started his campaign. Some of those faces look familiar from the campaign trail, and we know that it works. But let's focus on what's happening on the border right now. Jackie, CNN obtained emails saying essentially that the Customs and Border Protection Agency has stopped following the Trump administration's zero tolerance policy that led to the separation. So is this the new policy or is it still unclear what the new policy is?
I don't think anyone knows at this point, which is, and you know, I think the most concerning thing is these children, they don't know how they're going to be reunited with their parents yet. There is no plan. There is no, you know, they haven't released anything that shows that there is any sort of infrastructure, anything to start putting these families back together. Whether or not they're going to be in detention or in some other capacity, there's no plan. And just really quickly going back to that event, this is what Donald Trump does. He pits people against each other. And right now, it's so cynical. It's so cynical to take these people who have gone through unimaginable pain and pit them against children who've been separated from their parents. It is just the depth of cynicism on the part of the president and just politicism.
And meanwhile, the whole question is, despite the fact that he signed this executive order yesterday, we still don't know how these families are going to be reunited. And it just, Phil Mudd, you were in government for
forever.
A while.
It's a bad memory.
For a while. And look, I've never been in government, but I've certainly covered it enough administrations in Congress and elsewhere to know that when you have this kind of policy change, it takes months and months and months to get it right, to coordinate the agencies, to think 12 steps ahead, like, for example, when you separate children from their parents, what's going to happen. Never mind the fact that if you look at this White House right now, the person who probably would have coordinated this at the White House level, Tom Bossert, who was the Homeland Security czar, he's not there anymore. He was let go and he wasn't replaced. Now, this is also a White House where the president does something like this, and then everybody has to scramble to find the policy to fit the decision. But that is part of the problem here, right?
Sure. I mean, you look at this as a high-end policy problem. As a guy who escaped government some time ago, I look at it and say, this is when you need a pro in the White House. Think of all the implications of whether families are separate or together. Think of all the implications that you got to think through. Let me give you a handful I'd be thinking of. If families are together for months, do we vaccinate them? Do we start providing schooling? What about health, medical, dental care? What about somebody who's got a long-standing issue with, for example, incurable cancer? What are you going to do with that person? What if you have a mother who's pregnant in that camp? What are you going to do with that person? So you think about all the implications regarding just that small sliver of health and education. You realize why you need people in the White House and elsewhere to say, man, once we implement this, we better have about 200 pages of implementation documentation coming behind it. It's complicated.
And the winners here, there are winners in this policy. And it's the drug cartels, it's the gangbangers, it's the people that we all agree we've got to stop. It's people who murdered the family members of these poor folks who spoke out today. Mary Hatton's right, there is a problem, and there's
a
real problem.
Private prison contractors, they're doing pretty well, too.
Right. So we divert all of our resources to five-year-olds. And the cartels know what they're doing. I guarantee you they're exploiting this now to make it easier to get gangbangers in, because we're so distracted and diverted all of our resources to trying to find 2,300 children that we've separated.